There is a thirst in the country for a change of governance. However powerful the person is, I think at the end of the day, he has to bow down to the people's power. I think that people's power is building up. A large number within the government are very unhappy the way the country is run and way the family behaves. The decision that has been taken, I thought, was a very smart move. He's carrying the flag in the reform movement, we're all behind. And when the land is clean up, we'll peel it, then we'll give it to the people to decide. Before I die, I want to see that this country, first the democratic governance is restored in this country. So we clean up the system, bring system in, so that at least for the future, people can't rob the nation. So long as you are with the government, they are patriots. The moment you hold a different view, then of course they are traitors. But the so-called saviors of this country are not citizens of Sri Lanka. We are confident, and so are the astrologers. The stars also foretell that we'll form a government. I only go by the people pulse. I see the change. Unexpected quarters are talking about a change. Well, when election comes up, various names also are being talked about. Of course, in the first instance, I must tell you that I have never canvassed, applied or suggested that I should be considered. But when I look back, I find that, of course, theoretically what happens is when election of this sort comes up, is the party leader that's contest. That was our thinking. But due to the political climate at the time, even leader himself was having the idea that let's try to get everybody together. And when we discussed, we also thought that as leader of the opposition and as the party, the largest party in the opposition, that he has the right and the duty to unite all the forces. So we started doing so. But in the run-up to the election, various names are mentioned. But of course, it is up to the party to decide who should contest. And my stand has always been the party should decide at the appropriate time, taking the current circumstances into account. So the decision that has been taken, I thought, was a very smart move on the part of party leader and the working committee of the UNP. And I wholeheartedly support that. Because here we, in addition to the UNP votes, we are able to get part of the SLFP votes, because there are quite a large number of disgruntled members in the SLFP who have been tolerating the arbitrary attitude and the family bandism within the party. So we're talking to various ministers, deputy ministers, and MPs. We are convinced that a very large number within the government are very unhappy the way the country is run and way the family behaves. I believe that opposition is a good opportunity for the opposition to join hands and also to ensure that there is a thirst in the country for a change of governance. People need that change wherever you go, whether you go by train or bus or funeral or wedding. Everywhere people say enough is enough, and we want to say, and especially they don't want to see a family operated governance in this country. We are slowly but surely moving towards a North Korean type of governance in this country. That is not quite correct. I must say that if you mean that Mr. Mahinda Rajapaksa is the only person suitable to run the presidency after the 20 million people, I don't believe that. UNP is a party that's a very old established party, and look at the party leader. We have a leader who held the position of Prime Minister for 2 years, and he's a well respected and shown his results, good at governance, good at administration, hands are clean and internationally respected. So we have, and then we have also have quite a lot of, we have a very energetic and a very experienced team within the party. Then we have other opposition leaders, civil leaders. So they have plenty of people, and especially even the most favorable Madhulave Sobhita Thero's name was mentioned, because people have not realized the value of the role played by most venerable Madhulave Sobhita Thero. I remember on his 70th birthday, you know, he made a pledge that he will henceforth that he will ensure that rest of his life will be devoted to establish good governance in the country. That is how we also flocked around him. We also gave him the material possible moral support, and he would have been an ideal candidate if he was prepared to contest. But I know from the very beginning he had no idea of contesting. But his wish was to see that his wish also was to see that all the opposition forces are brought together. In fact, he was, in my understanding, he was playing the role of Bishop Tutu, the way he helped Nelson Mandela to free South Africa. So I think the role played by Venerable Madhulavi Sobhita will go down in history, because we have achieved something. We have been able to have some sort of consensus within the opposition. Maybe that all of them didn't sign together, but they have all signed for the change of governance. We go in different directions, but yet the prime motive is the change of governance. We are in that direction. I must tell you that organization is very close to Temple Trees, because I remember in 2005 when the present regime took power, they said one thing, Madin Natua Gooding End. I remember there were posters that were coming up. All these muddy posters are being designed from within the government. And we know, if the government think that we are fools, they are mistaken. We get all information as to where it is. We know where it was printed. We know where it was designed. We know who gave the idea. So it is actually, it's a government job. Well, I know it's not ethical for me to divulge the names, but we know the people behind. It was definitely planned and executed by the government. Because sad to say, Temple Tree, the official residence of the Prime Minister, now has become SLFP headquarters, where all the party operations are run there. I'm pretty sure that the ideologies that we are working together is threefold. One is the abolition of the executive presidency, then the reintroduction of the 17th Amendment, and the third one is the new electoral system. And on those three, we have a common opinion, we have agreed. And after all, we are not looking at years of governance. We are looking at just 100-day program. I would say 99 days program. Within this 99 days program, 100-day program, all what we have to do is just first clean up the land, clean up the land, because land is a spoiled land. We have to find out who was behind this. The people who have been killed are people who spoke against the government. So once the land is clean, then we have to go to the public. Within this 100 days, we are trying to bring systems into the country. After that, we go to the people, let the people of this country decide what political party should rule this country. The parliament will be dissolved, we go for the general election, and after that, we will decide. Let the people decide. After that, I'm very happy that party leaders, I've seen Honorable Ranil Wickremesinghe as our national leader, said after the election, let us go for a 2 and a half years of national governance. Honorable Maithripala Sirisena also hold the same view. Then I saw in the papers, Honorable Champika Ranawak also talking about government. So what we are trying to do is a government national reconciliation to rebuild this country. The country has been, if you look back, for example, in 1948, when we got independence, Sri Lanka was second only to Japan in terms of GDP. The difference between Japan and Sri Lanka was only $1. The Sri Lanka was a model country. Our public service was a model. Our police was a model. And the entire administration was a model. We had surplus money in the external account. All the development projects were done with our own money. So things due to politicization, bad management, country has come to this stage. Wrong decisions have been taken. So therefore, what we all want to do now is to put all the heads together. And we have quite a lot of very intelligent, very dedicated, very committed people within the present legislature. Bring everybody together and build the country for the sake of the next generation. That's what we do, and that is my dream. Because I am playing second innings in my career, so I don't have long-term political aspirations. But before I die, I want to see that this country, first, the democratic governance is restored in this country. Today there is no democracy in this country. Everything is done by a single person or a family, and they have become the rulers. So therefore, this must be changed. I mean, if you look at Sri Lanka from outside world, you can see how this is being run, how the judiciary is interfered with, and how everything, all the decisions are being taken. There are no transparency. The amount of money that is swindled, because we feel sad the way things happen. We are not fools. We know somehow that some of the tenders are awarded. They are not based on competitive bidding. And we also know the amount of difference of some of those projects. So it is, to me, it is a highway robbery. This is what we want to do. So we clean up the system, bring system in, so that at least for the future, people can't rob the nation. People can't behave like this. And let there be decency in the country. Let there be law and order. Let there be respect for each other. Let there be a free media, independent media. And that's all what we want. So after 2 years, or 2.5 years, let them once again go to the people and ask for a mandate. That can be done. And this is the best thing that can happen. And I hope it will happen. And as it is, I can see, we travel around the country. And wherever we go, we see a mass agitation from the people and a thirst from the people for a change. Well, because what matters is the stomach, no? The people have to live. And today, if you look at the cost of living in this country, it's unbearable. Because we know a lot of families in this country who barely manage with 2 meals a day. And about 40% of the people earn less than 250 rupees a day. And if you compare the cost of living in our country with Europe, and some of the food items in Europe are cheaper than in Sri Lanka. And the government is taxing in a lot of countries, the food items are not taxed. But here in Sri Lanka, food items also being taxed. So therefore, certainly we have a feeling for the people. We'll make sure that the people are in some way compensated, that they're able to, within that 100 days, we have to work out a program so there is some amelioration of people's grievances. So that has also been among the leaders, we have agreed that concession should be given. Once this waste is avoided, once this corruption is avoided, there's plenty of money available. If you look at the Sri Lankan losses, with that losses, if that losses can be avoided, we can give each family in this country 2 kilos of rice a week. Because we have talented people in our group who are good at management, who are good at administration. The reason for this sad situation is the lack of governance, lack of administration. Management. After the war, we thought the whole world will come and help us. That would have been the case if Sri Lankan government went to the world and said, okay, we fought the worst terrorists in the world, and then come and help us. They would have helped us. It happened in Germany. It happened to Japan. But instead of what we did, we went and they started harassing the opposition. They started celebrations. Celebrations, all right, that's no harm. But they took the wrong approach. Anybody talking about human rights, anybody talking about fundamental rights, anybody talking about press freedom, democracy, good government, labeled as tiger friends, or the agents of diaspora. While saying that, they are having all the tiger leaders, from the acting leader of LTT after Prabhakaran, KP is there. He's running like, he's behaving like a chief minister. Then deputy leader, Karu Jayasuriya, he's a senior vice president of the SLFP. Then all the section leaders, commanders are holding various positions. So how can they? And then the tiger who kills 600 police people, the tigers who destroyed the Radhamaligawa and the Sri Mahabodhi, they are all within the government. So they accuse us of tiger connection. So now we have intelligent vote base here. They can't play the fool, because last election they talk about Viduriputta, electric chair. People didn't accept that. Similarly, this tiger story, I don't think they can take anymore. Well, Mr. Nimal Siripal is not aware that for the last 3 years, This is a subject that has been talked about. Very eminent people in this country, very eminent Sri Lankans abroad have been studying this aspect. They have prepared the documents. And they are actually behind this movement. And even especially if you talk about Venerable Sobhita Thero's movement, one of the finest brains are behind this movement. They are not coming to the forefront. Very eminent public servants, scientists, engineers, lawyers, all those people are backing this movement. So actually, most of the legal changes necessary have been prepared during the last 3 years. And we know what we are talking about. It's possible. Well, this cohabitation program was discussed how best we could work out, and then also when the president comes from the government side, what is there for the opposition, and all this. Well, we have resolution as such, but various aspects were discussed by various people. But very frankly, I think what we want, including Mr. Nalvikki Messinger, this 100 days, we are not talking about, we have a mission. And the mission, as I told you, is to clean up the ground of dead bodies and waste and corruption and everything. So after that end of 100 days, let the people decide who's going to be the head of state, who's going to be the prime minister once they vote. So we leave it to the, we have no time to bother about that. We are more concerned about, and I must also tell you that majority of the UNPs, they are all welcoming this new arrangement. They thank the leadership of the UNP, they thank, and they are also very happy that somebody of the stature of Mr. Maithripala Sirisena come forward. He is also a very respectable man, and he doesn't carry a baggage as such, and he's no skeletons as far as we know in his cupboard. And he has sober ways. He's coming from the village background, Govia. I see in the political platform that about bias and various things, but he's coming from the Govi family, and they think that we can trust him. And in fact, he even just about 48 hours ago, he said, when I am elected, I'm not going to occupy even the presidential house. So this all, we are all talking about a short-term arrangement, so we don't want to fight, because actually he's carrying the flag. He's carrying the flag in the reform movement. We're all behind him. We are going there. And when the land is clean up, we'll peel it. Then we'll give it to the people to decide. We have absolute trust him. But also don't forget that today the whole country is giving the weight behind him. And the clergy and the religious leaders and all backing him. So he has no way of betraying that. But we know by his behavior and the fact that he's, when he said he's going to the the president's house, that showed that he has no lust for power. And as I haven't associated him very closely, but I think I have a lot of tremendous respect for him as a man, a simple man. A man of the people. And we have absolute trust in him, from Mr. Nalvikki Messinger downwards, all of us. None of our people have any reason to believe that he will not honor it. Well, promises made in the past were for to be made during the period of governance. You know, the governance is 6 years. But here, I mean, this is the first time that the entire opposition gets together and work out a deal for a reform just in a matter of 100 days. So within 100 days, we are satisfied that we can do it. And then so far, by talking to various people, I haven't come across anyone who is doubting this. And I associate the clergy of all religions. They have a lot of faith. And the average UNPS, I normally talk to about 30, 40 UNPS. In the morning, I talk to them and I get their ideas. And none of them have so far expressed any fears in this direction. And all of them say, so far, they say, it's a good decision. We are working through. We are very happy. We are very happy. A lot of SLFPs are also now talking to us. And now they, what is it, try to bring them together. I think Mr. Sirisena is that ideology is a noble mission, because the SLFP was born out of UNP, right? And I think that we two parties are the sort of, have been concurrently taking power. And it is definitely his duty, because he is not going to be UNP member, we are not going to be SLFP members. And I think what they are planning is to do to reform the SLFP into a pure Bandaranaike with Bandaranaike policies. See, at the end of 100 days, we go different ways and have elections. And then let the people decide whether it's a UNP government or SLFP government. But we think it's a UNP government. We work toward a UNP government. They'll work toward the SLFP government. The cross, when you put the cross, we don't look at any political party. The cross is for reform, nothing else. I think that's once again is coming from temple trees. I mean, as far as we understand, nobody has talked about it. They are very happy that she has come forward. We are all part of a team. And they are doing, we all put our heads together, we discuss together, we meet at operational leader's office once in a way, and we take the, nobody is putting, bullying anybody around. Well, in this election, we have a leading role, like in the case of General Fonseca's election, also as the leading political party. We took a very keen interest here also. I think the meetings are being planned, and our organizers, our local, our people's representatives, all will be engaged in the election campaign. And we also trying to amalgamate members from the opposition party. We are talking on that. We're also very happy that JHU also now coming into the system. So all of us will work in one direction. Well, that's the government usual stand of taking. Whenever there are people who take independent decisions, so long as you are with the government, they are patriots. The moment you hold a different view, then of course they are traitors. And we don't have to take instructions from embassies. Embassies have a different branch. And we love our country. We are going to bury our bones here. But the so-called saviors of this country are not citizens of Sri Lanka. Some of them are citizens of America. So therefore, they are reversing the roles. But I don't think people will buy that. We don't expect a free and fair elections. Even long before the election is announced, we found that the government started the election campaign. Now we respect president as the president of this country. There is one side. But the president of this country can't enjoy those perks and benefits as the candidate in this instance, or as the leader of the government. So what they are doing is the presidential perks, presidential power, presidential facilities is being used for the election. Now everybody here knows that temple trees is being used for entertainment. Over 5,000 people are given meals, lunchtime, sometime in the night, using government funds. And finally is cooked by service personnel. And then the bill is sent to the respective ministry. We have copies of some of those bills sent. So these people's money is all nothing but election propaganda. We have spoken on this subject to the election commissioner. We have spoken on this subject to experts in constitution. They all say gross violation of election laws. But whom to tell? Then the campaign office is in temporary. We are told that there are 165 days with computers. And they are doing the operations from there. Then meetings of the SLFP is held at temple trees. The use of government, because just after the announcement of the election commissioner, he sends a directive to all the secretaries, all the heads of department. They say, you can't use government property. You can't use government, they say, you can't use government helicopter, no government, then government vehicles. The media should be independent. And none of these are followed. Now, for example, when the propaganda office for the president was opened down Colombo 7, who was present on the occasion? 6 secretaries of ministries, governor of the central bank, 62 heads of government known undertaking. So where is this country heading? And how can you expect a free and fair election there? Then here last week we saw defense secretary addressing a meeting somewhere. Then again last week we saw a police inspector down Putnam lighting the oil lamp for the opening of the president's campaign office. So nothing happened. To whom can you say this? We don't have an election commission. And under the 18th Amendment, there are limitations to the Election Commission. I must say that the Election Commission and the Commissioner and the officials, they are doing their best to, you know, do an impartial job, but their hands are tied. I won't blame them. And this election is not going to be free and fair. But yet, the public perception is that people are so angry about the way the country is run. Well, we know this case has been put forward to the mayor. But I know mayors also, because also he's also being subject to a lot of control from the UDA. So in theory, yes, he has to. But whom is going to execute this? He has to use the police. The police are liable. There is the environment police who should do that. The mayor is doing his best to work out something. But his hands also tied with the current the system, current political culture. I cannot tell you from here why he's not doing that. But I know his hands also tied. I'm not trying to defend him. You know, I was also a mayor at that time. At that time, I remember I had no such pressures, you know, so we were able to do that. But today, it's different. Today, we have white vans. Today, we have threatening. Today, we have so powerful people who are interfering with the day-to-day running. And the defense ministry has so much of control over the Colombo municipality. Then there is the chief minister who is having control over the municipality. So therefore, I mean, he has to look at all those aspects. But still, we have told him to look at the respect, you know. Well, I believe that the most powerful power in the world is the people's power. However powerful a person is, I think at the end of the day, he has to bow down to the people's power. I think that people's power is building up. We have seen this happening in other countries. So if anyone tries to go against the people's decision, this time I don't think people will tolerate it anymore. I think people have been pushed to the wall, and the time is come, or time will come soon, that they will turn back. Well, I cannot tell you, it's not ethical to say and so is coming. But all indication that definitely some more dissidents will join this movement as time goes on, because now they realize that we are on the right track, and they believe that we can bring about drastic changes within the country for the benefit of the people and to establish democracy in this field, in this region. Definitely, and we are confident, and so are the astrologers. The stars also foretell that we'll form a government. I'm not a great believer in astrology, but still, it's a science. But from the people, I only go by the people pulse, and from what I see, what I hear, when I talk to people, I see the change. Unexpected quarters are talking about a change.
Fifty years of strength, trust and stability, offering high security and the best return for your investments. Licensed by the Monetary Board of Sri Lanka and serving you with 5 decades of trusted excellence. Mercantile Investments and Finance PLC, service that extends beyond. Call 0112-348-348.